Hi, y'all. I'm Charlie Daniels.
Hi, I'm Charlie Daniels Jr., and this is the Charlie Daniels Podcast. From long-haired country boy to simple man, the best there's ever been. As I'm working on this episode right now, it is Holy Week. And it's my intention to get this episode posted by Good Friday. Because this episode is about faith. It's about Dad's faith. It's about my faith. It's about the Christian faith and Easter and everything that goes with it. So we will be talking with Pastor Alan Jackson, no relation. He's not going to be going way down yonder on the Chattahoochee or anything. But he is a dear friend of the Daniels family. In fact, his entire family is a dear friend of the Daniels family. And we will talk about how that came about, talk about trips that Dad and I and Mom took to the Holy Land with them. And if you watched Dad's funeral, you saw Alan because he was one of the speakers. And World Outreach Church hosted the memorial service. I'm also going to be sharing some Easter memories with Dad, thoughts, and I'll be sharing part of one of the chapters of Dad's book, Never Look at the Empty Seats. He talks about his faith in this particular chapter, and he said it was the most difficult for him to write because he wanted to get it exactly right. He wanted to be able to put it into as precise but easy to understand terms as for somebody who may be looking, trying to find out what they believe and stuff. And he was just trying to kind of, it took him a while to really get to where he understood what Jesus dying on the cross meant for us. And he's just kind of now, he articulates that for us. So we'll be reading from that later. So you guessed it. This show is all about Jesus. He is risen. Okay, I need to apologize to Roger Campbell. We thank him for being a guest last time, but I forgot to mention something very important. Roger took the top of a road case, and I guess the bottom part had fallen apart. It was in disrepair or whatever. But anyway, Roger took it, and he used the stencil that they used for the for when they were actually going out on the road, and he stenciled Charlie Daniels and 1936 to 2020, and he included he put the truck emblem sticker on it. So those of you who are watching, and if those of you who are listening, I encourage you to either go to Apple Podcasts or go to charliedaniels.com/podcast, and the links to the video will be there all the time. But those of you who are watching, you can see this very cool, meaningful work of art that Roger has provided, and there's probably a good chance it's going to end up in a museum. I'm hoping we'll have more to talk about that soon. This interview is one that Dad did with Pastor Alan. In fact, a lot of the early interviews that I used on the podcast were taken from this interview with Pastor Alan. We just didn't have video back then. So anyway, I thought it'd be special to have Dad and Alan together on stage here. Dad's talking about his faith, and that's something that I've wanted to share from the very beginning of this podcast. But I was waiting to do a whole faith-based episode, and so it just worked out with this. So here is Dad and Pastor Alan.
I feel a kinship. I don't know any other way to explain it, and it's a feeling that you get. I have developed a love for Israel and for the Jewish people that it's hard to explain. I didn't understand until I knew we were supposed to pray for the peace of Jerusalem. I knew we were supposed to love the Jewish people, and I did, but not like I did after I went and saw the Holy Land. Mm-hmm. And it truly is the Holy Land, and to walk where our Lord walked, and to see the Old Testament and the New Testament all come together in a space of a few feet is amazing.
It changes our faith.
It changes your, it enforces your faith. It's like, you know, I understand more about about going from the old covenant to the new covenant. And of course, they still practice the old covenant to a big extent over there. But it's just such a, it becomes almost seamless, you know, to how it, the space of one night, one day, one night, or 3 days, I guess I should say, from the time that Jesus was crucified to the time he rose, that this all took place. And you know what's always fascinated me about this? The first person that was saved under the new covenant was a thief hanging on a cross that had, you know, had spent his whole life probably doing no telling what. And the very last, when his life was ebbing away, he asked Jesus to save him. And he did.
Amen.
You know, this episode is all about faith, about Jesus, about Easter, and going to be released on Good Friday. I just didn't feel right doing a whole pitch for merchandise this time. So I decided to kind of take a break with from that aspect of it. I am going to share the discount codes, but I'm not going to do all the other stuff that goes along with it. So the discount code this month to save 40% on all orders over $50 is Podcast APR. Podcast APR, all run together, Podcast APR. And that will save you, like I said, 40% on orders over $50. And for a little bit longer, Charlie Fiddle, Charlie and Fiddle, no spaces in between, all one word, will save you 20% on the Charlie Daniels Life Fiddle. So that's as commercial as we're getting with this one. So thank you. I first met Pastor Allen back in 2004, I think it was. Not sure, I think it was 2003, 2004, whichever it was. But we thought that we were just going to a one-off Easter celebration at Murphy Center, and that would be it. And we didn't know that it was going to turn into a lifetime of friendship. Here's my one-on-one with Pastor Allen Jackson. Hi, welcome to Twin Pines Studio again, and very excited to be able to bring this next guest to you. This is Pastor G. Allen Jackson. Did I get that right?
Just so they don't confuse me with the one who sings country music.
Right. So, pastor of World Outreach Church, which is has been our family church now for quite a while. I was thinking about we've known each other, our families have known each other for quite a while. I mean, was that first service around 2004 at Murphy Center?
Yeah, I think that'd be about right. We're close to 20 years.
Yeah, we're getting
We were
there.
Children together.
But Alan, his family, we have been to Israel with him. We have we've spent a lot of time with him over the years. He and his family are lovely people. His parents, his lovely wife, Kathy. We just thank the world of them. So I'm just very happy to be able to bring you here in front of the neon CDB sign. And we're going to talk about Dad. We're going to talk about faith. We're going to talk about Jesus. As we're recording this, I'm intending to this to be live by Good Friday. And so I'm hoping that will be the case. So I'm going to try it. So we wouldn't make it Easter themed. So anyway, thank you, Pastor, for joining us.
It's good to be with you, Charlie.
Yeah. And so how did everything come about for us to kind of be in each other's paths?
Well, I think God had to orchestrate that ultimately. Well, I grew up in Middle Tennessee.
Yes.
And my first memory of Charlie Daniels, other than the radio, was I had an old worn-out station wagon that I drove with an 8-track player in it.
Wow.
And I had Fire on the Mountain.
You're going back.
And so some of my misspent youth was spent with Charlie on the 8-track player in my station wagon. Yeah. But if we scroll forward a few years, and a great deal of God's mercy, we did Easter services for several years at MTSU's Murphy Center, which is a big arena. Mm-hmm. And we would invite a musical guest, and we reached out and asked your dad to come. And it was kind of a breakthrough for us because he represented a different level of talent to come to Murphy Center. And we did that for many years. And your dad and mom were the first artists we invited that stayed for Easter service.
Wow.
You know, everybody else would play, and then they'd slip out, which I understand. Everybody's got busy lives. But when I looked over and your mom and dad were sitting there, it was really the beginning of a relationship.
Yes, very much so. And the thing that, one of the early things that caught my attention, because I'm sure I was at the Sunday service for that, but you are very real. You're very human. You are not afraid to hide that you're a flawed, you know, human being just like all of us. And you had said that if you're working out in the backyard and you hit your head with a hammer, you know, the love of the Lord may not be what comes out of your mouth. And I was like, okay, this is a real human being. This is somebody that I can relate to. And I think there's a certain, there's a very much an appeal about that, that you're, we're all in this, you know, in life together through all the ups and downs. And there's not this faux piety that, you know, everything's perfect and in your life. No, you're a human being, and you've been through stuff just like everybody's been through. So, you know, I went away for a little while to another church, but I always knew I'd end back up at WOC, and so and mom and I have been going back. Well, we haven't even talked about any of the stuff. The church was locked out for many
COVID
months.
COVID craziness.
Yeah, and I'm kind of getting ahead of myself a little bit because we'll want to talk about something. But some of those Easter services, I know we did several at Murphy Center, and then one of them, one of the last ones that Dad did at the church, he did Don Francisco's He's Alive, and just give me chills. It was just an amazing performance. But the other thing, and we had your people were able to dig it out for us before the funeral, was How Great Thou Art, that he did at one of the Murphy Center services. And I have to be honest that I've had trouble listening to that song after Dad passed. In fact, I went to one of the Saturday night services, and I think they were doing baptism and outside, and they had just Vaughn and somebody were doing like a little acoustic thing. And I got in the car and I thought, well, Dad's got, you know, such a great version of this. And I listened to it, and it was just, I mean, it was waterfalls. And then at the volunteer jam, Michael W. Smith and CeCe Winans did it. And again, I've had trouble listening to that song ever since. I mean, it's because it was Dad's favorite hymn, and it meant a lot to him.
So, it's still out there on YouTube. So if somebody wants to go find it, they can hear it.
So yes, very much so.
One of the memories I have of your dad that first Easter.
Yes.
He built his set, and it was kind of traditional Christian music. Mm-hmm. And the arena's filled, and the stage was in the center. And I walked up on stage and said, "Charlie, you can't come in here on Easter. This is what the mic did."
Right.
And not do The Devil Went Down to Georgia. We're standing on the stage. And he said, "Pastor, I can't sing that at an Easter service." And I said, "Well, I'm the pastor, and I think you can."
Yeah.
So he looked at the audience, and he said, "I don't want to do it, but Pastor says I have to." So we did The Devil Went Down to Georgia on Easter.
Yeah. You know, what's funny about that is that back when that song first came out, the promotion men from CBS Epic at the time, I mean, it started to break, you know, obviously it broke country. It started breaking pop, and then on rock radio as well. But a promotion man was driving out in the Midwest somewhere, and he heard it on the radio, and you know, wanted to see what station it was. And when it got to the end, and it was the Son of a Gun version, just to be clear. And at the end, a pastor came on and says, "That's right, you too can beat the devil." So this guy built a whole sermon around Devil Went Down to Georgia. It may not be, you know, it may not be a you don't want to do what Johnny did, but it's still, you know, the overall message was there. But so I was going to ask you about that, but thank you for bringing that up. One thing I was going to talk about was we did go to Israel with you, with your family, and with the whole church group from World Outreach. And we had just an amazing time. I know Mom and Dad went a couple more times than I did. But that first time, because if I highly recommend going to Israel, because and like I said, we're right before Easter, to go and see everything and be able to visualize it. It's one thing to kind of try to visualize it in your head, but you can go down, on the, around the temple, and they've excavated. You can go to the rabbi's tunnel, and you know, and stand on the other side of it. You can walk down the Via Dolorosa. You can all these the garden tomb that we went to, which was just
Mount of Olives.
I mean, so to go and see all of these places, it just enriches your experience, because it's I mean, it's hard to visualize some, you know, some things. Like I remember Ronnie, the tour guide, Ronnie Simone, on one of it was one of the seminars that I had heard him say that somebody he talked to thought that the Mount of Olives was like, I don't know, like 10-20 miles away from Temple right. Mount, and it's just right there. It's just, you know, so you don't, you know, it's hard to get all of the geography of it and stuff, but it's, anyway, you had some stories on the interview that when you interviewed Dad about his book when it came out, you had some observations and some things that you remembered from some of the trips over there.
Well, I had the privilege of traveling with your parents to Israel more than once. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I think together we probably learned a lot about Israel in our Bibles, but I learned a lot about life from just hanging out with them. Yeah. You know, your mom always had a Sharpie and chewing gum. And we would be in some of the most remote places in Israel, and somebody would look through the window of the bus and recognize your dad. Mm-hmm. And she'd hand him his chewing gum and his Sharpie, and he would get off the bus and sign whatever they had.
Right.
And I never one time heard him complain. People were not an intrusion in his life.
Never.
He treated them as if they had been friends forever, and mm-hmm. I think people felt that way.
Very much so. I mean, he never met a stranger, and if he was talking to you, you were the most important person in the world at that point.
Absolutely. So. And I took that away because, you know, I'm in the ministry, and a lot of times professional Christians act like people are an intrusion.
Right.
And I watched Charlie, and I thought, you know, if he can do that with the career he's had in the music business, mm-hmm. surely I can treat people with some dignity and respect
right.
in the name of the Lord. Yeah. So I felt like I learned more on that trip than he did about Israel.
Well, and he very much did feel that way. He and I Mom was out of town on some rare occasion when I was growing up, and Dad was off the road, and we were going to go to a movie together, and we were looking through the movie listings, and I won't give the artist's name, but there was an artist that was pretty big in the late 70s, early 80s, and he had refused to sign an autograph for someone because he was sitting down eating, and you can certainly, you know, say, yeah, that was probably not the proper thing to do, but Dad got really, it was in the newspaper near the movie listings is how we came across it. And Dad was he was fired up about it because he said, and he even actually wrote a piece to the newspaper that they published in kind of response. And Dad's take on it was, I've worked for many, many years for someone to want my autograph. And even if it inconveniences him a little bit, it's no big deal. So he was, and he and this other artist, you know, they became friends and stuff. So it's, you know, I think it was just a little moment of ego that had kind of gotten to his head. But anyway, it's, it changed after that. But anyway, there was another story about a coffee pot, I think I remember.
Yes. We were in a restaurant having breakfast.
Uh-huh.
And Kathy, my wife and I were down a little early, and there was another group of Americans at a table, and they were from the New York Jewish community.
Okay.
So we didn't expect they knew a lot about Nashville or country music. Right. And Charlie walked in, and Kathy had been interacting with them and asked them if they knew Charlie Daniels.
Uh-huh.
And there was one man at the table that said, yes, I know him. And he acted like he was playing the fiddle for the devil right. went down to Georgia. So when Charlie came in, Kathy sent him over to their table with a coffee pot to pour their coffee. And they looked like they had had an encounter with the Lord because right. it was unexpected. But that, he had such a heart for people.
Yes.
And it showed up, you know, at church. He'd come to church without his hat on, mm-hmm. and he would go unnoticed.
Yep.
And the people were respectful of him. But I watched him be kind and gracious to people in so many occasions. That's a wonderful legacy to have.
Absolutely. And you know, good lessons, you know, good role model, you know, for me, obviously. But on that trip, the first trip that I took, we were talking about, like, little funny things that happened. We pulled up at on our bus near Temple Mount. And I was sitting on one side of the bus, and on the other side, I kind of saw this kind of a little, you know, hubbub going on and wasn't sure what it was, and looked out there. And I'm going to put it up on the screen for us, everybody, so you can see what I'm talking about. But there was this mural for something they were building nearby. And there was a gentleman that was bent over like he was reading a newspaper. It was a painting or a photograph that had been put on this wall. And it was a dead ringer for Dad.
That's the truth.
And I actually, we got him to go out, and he actually sat next to it. So those of you who are watching the podcast, you'll actually get to see that. Those of you who are listening, you need to be watching the podcast. But that was a fun moment. But it was, there were so many amazing experiences there. But like I said, the most important thing about it, that it really helps bring the Easter story to life more so than, you know, than just, you know, trying to visualize it. And it's, you know, it was one of the most, you know, powerful, life-changing experiences in my lifetime, for sure. But it's, you know.
Well, and your dad's love for the military. We mm-hmm. got to visit some Israeli, the IDF right. military bases, mm-hmm. and he got to talk to some of those young men and women, and he had such a passion and a heart for them. Mm-hmm. He was an encouragement to them. One of my favorite memories is one of the wasn't the time you were there, but we were there during the Feast of Tabernacles.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I remember hearing about this.
And we were in there, the convention center in Jerusalem, mm-hmm. and it was filled with a Jewish audience that night. It was a convention, or it was a meeting sponsored by some international Christians, but that was the Israeli night. Mm-hmm. And there was a band that was built out of international musicians, and Charlie had agreed to do a couple songs. So he gets there early to get prepared, and Hazel says, "Watch this. He'll teach those people to play country." Mm-hmm. and so we sat there. I was fascinated.
Yeah.
It took him about 10 minutes to get a group. I mean, some of them were from Scandinavia, and some were European, and some were Asian, and he teaches them their country stuff.
Yeah.
So the program starts, and your dad and I are backstage, and I'm going to go out to introduce him. And just as I'm walking out, he says, "I got a little surprise for you, Pastor." And I thought, dear God, because that could have been a lot of things.
Yeah, right.
So I introduced him, and he walks out, and he starts to play HaTikvah, the Jewish national anthem. Mm-hmm. And that room went completely still. And in a moment, the people start to stand up, and there are tears running down their faces. Mm-hmm. And when he finishes that, he doesn't miss a beat, and he goes right into I'll Fly Away.
Yep.
And I mean, when he got to the end of it, I'll never forget it. He looked at them and he said, "One day I'm going to walk out on my porch and lift up my eyes to heaven, and I'm going to fly away."
Amen.
And he did.
Yeah, he did. And
if I'd have known he was really going to do it, I'd have torn the porch off your house that day.
Pastor Allen, his wife Kathy, his parents George and Betty, they will be lifelong friends of the Daniels family. We were baptized in the Jordan River with the Jacksons. We stared out over the Jezreel Valley, which is the plains of Armageddon, together. We walked the Rabbi's Tunnel in Jerusalem, which takes you along the buried temple walls under the Muslim quarter around Temple Mount. So we could actually stand on the same streets that Jesus stood on But they're buried now after years of destruction and rebuilding. So, but we've got a lot more with Alan next time, and we're looking forward to it. So we will do part two. Telling Dad's faith journey is something that I've wanted to do from the very beginning of this podcast, but I wanted to do it right, and Easter and Good Friday seemed like the perfect time to do it. So without further ado, I'm going to actually read part of a chapter. We'll probably have to split it up because it's a long chapter, but it's about Dad's faith from Never Look at the Empty Seats. So here it is. I hope you enjoy it. Heart of my heart, rock of my soul, you changed my life when you took control. Up until now, I've only mentioned my faith, but I have not gone into detail about how I believe. I've been asked about my testimony many times, and I have never really formulated a cohesive response. The story goes through many phases and covers many years, and is still a very ongoing part of my life. I was raised in a Christian family, and from the time of my earliest remembrances, I had heard the phrase, "Jesus died for our sins." As I look back, I accepted it as fact, although I had little comprehension as to what that actually meant and how it applied to the salvation of my soul. So I was still of the opinion that it had to do with my performance rather than what Jesus Christ had done on the cross 2,000 years ago. I had to prove myself worthy. Any sin I committed could remove all the good I'd ever tried to do and cancel out my salvation, whatever I perceived it to be. The impossibility of living a totally sin-free life didn't really register in my young mind. Doubt and confusion set in, reinforced by the strict doctrine of the church I was going to at the time. That church frowned on women cutting their hair, going to movies, and the wearing of makeup and jewelry, and had zero tolerance for alcohol and tobacco. It basically favored a cloistered lifestyle away from the wiles of the world and the temptations of society. If you asked about the liberal consumption of wine in the Bible, the stock answer was it was not the kind of wine that would lead to inebriation. It was some form of mild grape drink that was only referred to as wine. When it is a bogus answer because there are accounts in the Bible of people getting inebriated from consuming too much wine. If drinking wine was a sin, why would Jesus change water into wine? Now, I am not promoting the use of alcohol, and I am certainly not condoning overindulgence. But as Paul said in 1 Corinthians 6:12, everything is permissible to me, but all things are not helpful. Overindulgence in many things is bad for you, and good sense and moderation in all things is the answer. But to twist the scriptures to make a theological point that suits your purposes or supports your dogma could open a whole plethora of questions to someone seeking clarity and truth. I know there is a lot of symbolism and mystery in the Bible, but it is my belief that most scripture can and should be taken literally. When it says that a whale swallowed Jonah, I believe it means that Jonah was swallowed whole by a gigantic fish. When it says that Jesus broke a few loaves of bread and fish and fed 5,000 people, I believe it happened just that way. When the Bible says that the walls of Jericho fell or that the Red Sea opened so the Israelites could go through the other side, I believe that the waters parted and stayed that way long enough for a million people or more, men, women, and children, plus their livestock and possessions to cross. Substance, not symbolism. I was once told by a lady of that church that if you were in a movie house, when Jesus came back, he wouldn't have time to come and get you. In my understanding, it all happens in the twinkling of an eye. If you are a believer, I don't think the walls of a movie house could hold you. I never stopped believing. I just realized that I couldn't live a totally sinless life, especially according to the legalistic minutiae that deemed so many mundane, basically harmless human actions as sins. I sometimes think that so many churches and well-meaning pastors take for granted that people know the basics of salvation when they walk through the door. They forget that there are those who don't understand why Jesus' sacrificial death brings eternal life to all who repent, believe, and accept. When someone is threatened with hell every Sunday and has drawn the conclusion that the only way they can avoid it is to live a perfect life, they many times become disillusioned and bitter. Then, realizing the futility of such an undertaking, they start imagining God as a vengeful, patriarchal-type deity who is just waiting for one little transgression to revoke your salvation. Actually, the Bible tells us that God is love. He demonstrated His great love by sending His only begotten Son to die the most painful and humiliating death imaginable, so that we might obtain life everlasting. Now, what does that all mean? I decided years ago to read the Bible and draw, as best as I could, my own conclusions. I needed to try to work out my own salvation as I believed every person has to. As the old song says, you've got to walk that lonesome valley, you've got to go there by yourself. Ain't nobody gonna go there for you. You've got to walk it by yourself. Why did God do it that way? He is all-powerful and could have forced everybody to abide by His will. While there are many ways to the mountaintop, why do I have to go through Jesus to get there? I answer these questions based on my own understanding, by my own conviction and beliefs. I have never had any formal theological training and do not by any means consider myself an expert. I do not ascribe to, nor necessarily disagree with, the doctrine of any organized Christian denomination. I have drawn my conclusions according to my own interpretations of the Holy Bible and the interpretations of biblical scholars and teachers whose opinions I agree with. And from my point of view, here is what it all means. When God sent His Son to earth, He instituted a new covenant to replace the old covenant, the terms of which had been given to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the forefathers of the Jewish race. Then there were the commandments and laws that were given to Moses during the Israelites' 40-year sojourn in the desert. The Bible says that without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. The old covenant required animal sacrifice. Animal blood had to be shed to cover the sins of the people. Why did God do it this way? I honestly don't know. But since His wisdom is so much greater than ours, we should just accept that He knew what He was doing. Animal sacrifice was not as cut and dry as it sounds. You couldn't just go out into the pasture and get some old dry cow that had stopped having calves and take it to the priest to be sacrificed. It had to come from the very best you had. I have likened it to giving one of my best herd bulls or one of my best blooded heifers. God demanded the best of the flocks and herds for blood sacrifices. It was giving up something that was of real value to you. And God gave laws and instructions on how to live, dietary guidelines, and outlines for worship. There was the setting aside of Sabbaths and holy days and seasons that were to be observed in specific ways. There was eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth justice, and laws about how it was to be meted out and at the proper time and method to offer the sacrifices. This was the way of atonement for thousands of years. But humans, being what they are, started trying to exploit the system by ignoring the spirit it represented. They started trying to read between the lines and came to the conclusion that it was permissible to do anything that was not specifically forbidden by law. We will have more of Dad's faith chapter from Never Look at the Empty Seats next time. But before I go, I wanted to tell you about my own personal Easter tradition. Every year on Good Friday, I sit down and make myself watch The Passion of the Christ. Now, it's an amazing movie, but I don't watch it for the enjoyment of it. I watch it to remind me what our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, or Yeshua, if you prefer, suffered for my sins. By the end of the movie, I've shed so many tears that if someone saw me, I think they would take away my man card. But I feel it's the least that I can do. If I start getting caught up in the challenges that life throws my way, this is a course correction and one I can, will continue to make. It is just the least I can do to watch what our Lord and Savior endured for our salvation. That's all we have time for. We will read more from Dad's faith chapter next time and have more with Pastor Allen for all things CDB, the podcast, new releases, merchandise, and more. Go to charliedaniels.com and be sure to subscribe wherever you get your podcasts so you know when the next episode drops. And watch us on video. I'm not that horrible to look at most of the time. So anyway, this is Charlie Daniels Jr., and let's all make the day count. And don't forget, Benghazi, it ain't going away, no matter how much they want it to. Neither is Afghanistan, and I think we can add Ukraine to that list. I'd love to hear what Dad would be saying right now. He would be fit to be tied.